Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the April 10th meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Would you all please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
The Pledge of Allegiance is the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We have the roll call, please.
Chairman Garvin.
Here.
Councilor Grennan.
Here.
Councilor Caitlin Jordan.
Here.
Councilor Penelope Jordan.
Here.
Councilor Lennon.
Here.
Councilor Ray.
Here.
And Councilor Sullivan.
Here.
Thank you very much. The first item on the agenda tonight, we have a special guest with us. So I'm actually going to go over to the podium over here. Good to see you back again.
Good to be here.
Glad to see you're doing well. Look very relaxed.
Very good to be here and good to leave in a few minutes. Good luck with the budget.
More than a few minutes, I think. But in any case, in December, this council, in recognition of your service to the community and your dedication to your role as town manager and for all the work that you've put in for nearly four decades, here in this community and certainly in this very room, we took the action to dedicate this room in your honor. I'm going to read this dedication here. This room is dedicated to Michael K. McGovern in honor of his dedicated service to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth as town manager from May 1985 to December 2016, dated the 12th day of December 2016, Cape Elizabeth Town Council.
Thank you.
Pleased to present this to you. It really speaks to, you know, we've dedicated the chamber in your name, but I think there's no more apt word than describing the dedication that you have and had and continue to have for this community. So we're very grateful, and forevermore we'll be holding our meetings in the McGovern dedicated chambers. So congratulations.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you. I very much appreciate it. It was 40 years ago next month I first came to this room as an intern, quite a lot of enjoyable times, and this is truly an honor. I'm glad you found an old photograph, Deborah, and thank you.
But wait, there's more. You said you're only going to be here for a minute, but we're not quite done yet. So. Another great honor that we look to bestow upon you tonight is we'd like to officially recognize you this year as the recipient of the Ralph Gould Award. For those that don't know, the award was established in 1986, and it was named for the late Ralph Gould to recognize his community service and subsequently to recognize those who provide community service in the same spirit as Ralph Gould. There's a long and distinguished list of names of recipients who have received this award before you. But I would say that any list, no matter how lengthy, would be completely and totally incomplete without your name being added to it, which we choose to do here today. So it gives me great pleasure to announce Mike McGovern as the 2017 recipient of the Ralph Gould Award. Congratulations.
You know, I did know about that. This is a surprise. You know, one of the great joys of working in this community, and I see the list in front of me, I've had the honor of knowing every single recipient of this award. It's wonderful to be in the company of such great folks, so thank you very much. Good luck. I'm leaving. Thank you all.
Good night.
Good night. I guess too long.
Okay. The next item up on the agenda is Town Council reports and correspondence. Any councilors wish to make a report at this time? Patty.
Yeah, I just have a brief announcement that tomorrow, on Tuesday, the 11th, from 12 to 1 p.m., the Ordinance Committee will be meeting, and we're going to be continuing to talk about two things, the shooting range ordinance technical amendments. We're getting close to that and hope to have something to the council by next month. The other thing is that we will begin, and we started last, a couple weeks ago, but we'll continue the dialogue on the legalization of marijuana and the possible implications and what those mean for Cape Elizabeth. So that'll be on our agenda tomorrow. So it's downstairs below us in the conference room. So if you're free, come join us. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other councilors wish to make a report at this time? Penny?
I wanted to report on the comprehensive plan and the work that's happening there. We have identified the consultant for the public participation because our objective is to engage as much of the community as we can as we develop our comprehensive plan. And our next step is to identify the public opinion consultant, which will be more of a detailed survey approach. But I'd like people in the community just to stay apprised of what's happening with the comprehensive plan, because it's a significant part of what we'll be doing over the next several years in this community.
Thank you. Any questions for Penny? Any other reports? I have one. So there's been some inquiries in the past couple of days. I know the council received an email today, which I responded to, but for the benefit of the audience and those watching, we have had some inquiries about the status of the Spurwink School. Some of you remember, may remember that a committee was formed last year in order to look at potential reuses for the now vacant Spurwink School now that the library, the renovated library, has opened. We met regularly and extensively through the better part of last year, and then effectively the work we were doing kind of stagnated and came to a bit of a halt, and also sort of fell to the back burner a little bit from the perspective of other priorities and competing time commitments that both committee members and staff had. So that all being said, the work is incomplete, and it's certainly my intent and also my responsibility to ensure that it does get finished up. So we will be reconvening that group so that we can complete the work that we were charged with, which was to make a recommendation to the council and then have the council consider what to do from that point forward. So if there are any questions from anybody, I'm happy to take them, but otherwise look for that work to get re-engaged very soon. Okay, seeing none. Jessica, would you give us the finance report for this month, please?
Yes, you all have your dashboards. Again, I want to thank the town manager, Matt Sturgis, and Catherine Messmer, the business manager, and working with us every month, as we have been. Excise taxes are still climbing. We're $48,293 to the good on that. Our debt balance is $15,569,641. We're retiring in June. $1,650,648, so that's good. I did notice a shortfall in the cable franchise fee, and so I asked the town manager to just give us a little update on that and also to tell us how that all works with the cable company. Sure. So if you would, please.
Sure. The cable franchise fee is roughly, well, by contract, it's 5% of their general or their gross annual revenue. Should be paid to the town on their annual fees. So as they get more subscribers, then that number should grow. As they get less, obviously the number should shrink. We did notice, we did get two payments at the start of March. They're contractually obligated to pay us at the beginning of March per their agreement. And we had received two payments from them with a total of $140,629. And so that necessitated a call to our Charter Communications. And I had the opportunity to speak with one of their representatives, and they've been going through, if you had noticed, a little bit of an acquisition, merger and acquisition phase in their company. Spectrum purchased Time Warner, and Charter is taking care of their billing for them. So the gentleman I spoke to did not know the answer as to why there was a shortfall. And they also, with their checks, had provided us the explanation that they did not have their gross annual revenues number for the year yet. I think they're still, quite frankly, pulling it all together. So he said he was going to get back to me. I have yet to hear from him. So I've been calling as well. Famous for the cable company, you call, you get frustrated. So I guess no difference in my life as well. So I will maintain my calls on that to get that from them, because traditionally we've been in the $150,000 plus range annually. So, and I don't anticipate that there'll be a, you know, that's a pretty significant change, 10 grand basically from one year to the next, when they've been around 150 to 155,000 consistently. So I don't know if they've lost that many subscribers, but I'll be anxious to see what their gross revenues are. Just as in concert with that, their agreement began February 22nd, 2008, and it runs, it's a 15-year agreement, so it goes until 2/22 of 2023, and there is a five-year renewal. So if the town decides that they're not satisfied with that, we have to let them know 6 months in advance that we're looking to change our agreement. So we've got some time to decide on that, but as far as the others go, as soon as I receive an update from them as to what their gross revenues were and what they're looking to provide us, then I'll provide an update to the council. But at this point in time, that's what we're looking at.
Okay. Thank you, Matt.
Sure.
To continue, as you know, we are in the midst of budget season. Tomorrow night, the school board will vote to adopt its year 2018 budget. The superintendent is proposing a 2.9% increase in spending above last year's school budget. This would potentially result in a 5% tax rate increase. The school board will present its adopted budget to the town council for approval at a workshop on April 25th at 7 p.m. here at Town Hall. As always, this meeting is open to the public, and we hope you will all attend. On the municipal side, for fiscal year 2018, the town manager is proposing a 1.4% increase in spending above fiscal year 2017. This would potentially result in a 2.5% tax rate increase. If both proposed budgets are approved by the town council and the voters, Cape Elizabeth could see a combined property tax rate increase of 7.5%. There will be a public hearing on Monday, May 8th, at 7 p.m. here at Town Hall on both the school department and municipal budgets. On May 15, the town council will convene for a special budget adoption meeting. And finally, on June 13, the school department budget will go to the voters for referendum validation. And I have a request for the council, a consensus straw poll, if you will. In the past, there has been discussion on whether to videotape the school, combined school budget and town meeting, town council meeting. And I think that that is an excellent idea. And so what I would like to receive consensus by the council that to go ahead and plan to videotape the April 25th meeting. So I'm wondering if what you all think.
Yeah, sure. Have it on TV.
Exactly. Videotape, yeah. Like tonight. Yeah. Okay. Great.
Yeah.
Thank you. So I'll work on that with the town manager. I ask that also because, again, it's been a discussion in the past, and when you think of it, this is probably by magnitude the most important financial meeting or workshop that we undertake on an annual basis, and I think it deserves that attention. So thank you very much.
Any questions for Jessica? Seeing none. We now have opportunity for citizen comment on any items not on the agenda. Is there anybody from the public that wishes to step forward to comment on something not on tonight's agenda? Seeing none, Matt, turn it over to you for the monthly report from the manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, this past month was a busy one, with the budget being the primary focus, with two budget workshops being held on March 21st and the 22nd. And the end result to this point is that a municipal budget with a 1.4% increase in spending and a 2.5% net increase would result in an 11-cent increase on the tax rate for municipal services. To give you a dollars and cents perspective, that would equate to about $33 for our $300,000 home for a $500,000 home, $55 increase from one year to the next on the municipal side. So if you can, you know, whatever your value is, if you multiply it by 11 cents, you can kind of do the math. The next budget-related item is a workshop, as Jessica said, with the school board on April 25th, when the council and the school board will meet to receive and review the school budget. On March 24th, I had the opportunity to attend the manager's interchange in Bangor, and the program was specifically centered on the legalization of marijuana and the impacts and the changes coming forward. The keynote speaker was a former manager of Frisco, Colorado, and there were also speakers related directly to the legal questions and issues that towns will face with their ordinances. I'm planning on sharing with the Ordinance Review Committee some of my perspectives and some of the information that I received, so I'll try to pull that together for being able to work with that. The interesting perspective between Colorado and Maine, the difference is in Colorado they have local option sales tax, and that is what's generating the lion's share of the revenue for the communities that are impacted by it. So to kind of give you a different perspective, in Frisco, their property taxes are $125,000 of their annual revenue, and they receive about $1.25 million in sales tax revenue related to marijuana sales. So they kind of have things on a completely different perspective than we have. But some of the other ills or other issues that were related to marijuana legalization, they've definitely felt, and so I'll be happy to share that with the Ordinance Review Committee as we go forward. On April 3rd, the second half property tax bills were due, and in between March 30th and April 4th, almost $11.1 million was received by the town, and primarily right through that office. And I want to take a moment to thank Deborah Lane and her staff for doing exemplary work, as usual, because of their efforts, and to take care of that, it helps us all, specifically our bottom line. At this present time, the town has collected 96% of the original property tax commitment of $29.6 million. So there are others who, you know, will collect between now and the end of the year, and Deborah will be sending out our 30-day notices as they go forward. But for a budget of that size, Cape Elizabeth does and has traditionally had a very solid success rate when it comes to collecting municipal taxes. So they've done very well with that. And Deborah, well done by you and your staff, so thank you.
Thank you.
Today, and good news, if you happen to look on the website, Community Services received delivery of the new minibus. So it's hot on the press. It's 14-seater, looks fantastic, has all the full decals on it, and they're looking forward to providing more program for the community. The new bus is handicapped accessible, and I think it's going to be great for senior programming and small group trips. So I know Kathy Raftus was right behind the wheel and looked like she was ready to go, so but it looks great. And then finally, on April 29th, residents will be allowed to bring in their unused and unwanted prescriptions and over-the-counter medications to the Cape Elizabeth Police Department from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. for disposal. Residents should take advantage of this opportunity to clean up their medicine cabinets and dispose of the unwanted medications in a safe and environmentally friendly manner. For more information, if you'd like to, contact Officer David Galvin at 767-3323, extension 208. And that has been a very successful program in the past, and we hope to continue it to do so. We actually receive credit from Portland Water District because that's not entering the waste stream as well, which is a very significant health and safety concern. So all in all, that's a great thing. So if you have old medications lying around, please bring them in on that day. And that is the manager's report, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Any questions for Matt? Thank you very much. Next item up on the agenda is the review of the draft minutes of the March 13th meeting. Are you looking for a motion to approve the minutes from the March 13th meeting?
I so move.
Is there a second? Sarah, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Next item is number 60-2017, opportunity for public comments on the fiscal year 2018 budget. As Jessica alluded to in the financial report earlier, we will be having subsequent workshops as the council, as well as tomorrow's school board meeting for them to vote on the school budget. But if there's anybody that wishes to come forward now to make any comments on any items on the fiscal 2018 budget, you're welcome to do so. Seeing none, Next item is number 61-2017. That's a request by the Inn by the Sea to approve the renewal of their malt, spirituous, and Venus liquor licenses and special amusement permits. Caitlin.
I just have to disclose that my family business does business with the Inn by the Sea.
Thank you very much. Are there any counselors that have any concern about Caitlin's professional work with the Inn by the Sea? No? Thank you. Annie, did you have a question?
Nope.
Okay.
All set.
Is there a motion?
Let me do it. Okay, great. So I move to approve the renewal malt, spirituous, and vinous liquor licenses and special amusement permit by the Inn by the Sea located at 40 Bowery Beach Road.
Is there a second?
Second.
Penny, any discussion? Kathy.
I think we always ask the question if there has been any issues. Usually the police chief indicates if there's been any problems, so I'm asking the question.
Thank you, Kathy.
Yep, no instances or issues have been reported.
Thank you.
Any other questions or discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Great, thank you very much. Next, we'll have a public hearing on the well at Jordan Farm and their application for a qualified catering license.
And I'll need to recuse myself from this.
Thank you. Would the council's, would somebody like to make a motion to on Penny's recusal? Thank you, Jessica.
Yes, Jamie. I move that we accept Councillor Penny Jordan's wish to recuse herself from item number 62-2017.
Thank you. Is there a second? Kathy? All those, any discussion? All those in favor? Great. I'll now open the public hearing. If you would speak on this matter, please step forward to the podium. Please limit your comments to about 3 minutes, which I will time. And if you step forward to speak, just give us your name and your full address, please. So anybody wishing to speak on this, please come forward. The public hearing is now open. Seeing none, the public hearing is now closed. Next item, number 62-2017, application for the well, Jordan Farm, seeking a qualified catering approval. Is there a motion? Caitlin.
I just have to disclose that my family business also does business with the well.
Okay. Do any counselors have any concerns about Caitlin's stated conflict or potential conflict? Seeing none. Is there a motion on the application? Sarah.
I move that we approve a qualified catering application for the well at Jordan Farm 21 Wells. Am I moving that we approve the application or that we approve the actual catering?
It's the application.
It's an application. It's,
oh, okay,
that's the
sorry.
That's the use. So
start
that's,
over.
Yep.
So I move that we approve a qualified catering application for the well at Jordan Farm, 21 Wells Road.
Is there a second? Patty.
I'll second that.
Any discussion?
Yep.
Jessica.
I mean, I'm in support of the motion. I'm just curious. I just have a question. Required for catering with liquor on and off premises. How does that work? I mean, is it the catering and transporting alcohol to a location within Cape Elizabeth, is that, or through Cape Elizabeth?
Yeah, because they're based out of Cape Elizabeth, that's why the approval takes place here. And then if they want to have alcohol and cater, then this is the license that you'd have versus a regular liquor license when you'd have to have all that on hand and the inventory and all that. So it's more of a special okay. use type of liquor license.
All right, thank you.
Any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion? Great. Unanimous, thank you.
I was just wondering how the heck did that.
Next is item number 63-2017, Town Council resolution on welcoming all people. Councillor Lennon, do you want to introduce this item? And I know we have some people from the public that wish to comment on it as well.
Yeah, very briefly, Jimmy Wagner called me, former counselor, and explained that a group had come together called the Cape Diversity Coalition, and they had done some great work already in the schools, and I know the school has been working too around a lot of these issues. And they suggested that it would be great to have both the schools and the town together on this progress, and I agreed with them wholeheartedly. So we had a quick meeting, some of the folks here, and I was really impressed and excited about this. So I'm very much hoping that other counselors will also think that this is a great idea. And I'll let, I think it looks like almost the whole group is here. I'll let them, whoever members want to speak to it, do we need a motion, or can they come speak?
I would ask that if one or two of you from the group wants to come forward and just speak to the item, since it's a citizen-generated item, if you would like to speak to it, please do.
Hi there, thank you. I'm Susanna Mazel-Hubbs. I live at 18 Belfield Road. I don't know if you need to know that, but here I am. I want to thank the town council, town manager, for their time and consideration they have spent thus far on the resolution brought forward tonight by the Cape Diversity Coalition. The Cape Diversity Coalition is a growing group of inspired people who strongly believe that standing on the side of diversity, respect, and kindness is the only way. Furthermore, it is also the best way to sustain Cape Elizabeth's true bounty and beauty. Our town has the opportunity tonight to make a proactive and symbolic commitment to welcoming and protecting the rights of any and all of our community members and visitors. I urge you to join our neighboring towns, Portland, Westbrook, and South Portland, and speak out confidently in favor of love and acceptance. I urge you to model for our children that hate is not tolerable and silence is cowardly. And lastly, I urge all of us to stand together as true beacons of life, liberty, and light. Thank you for your time.
Hi, my name is Jim Sparks, and I'm not proud of this, but I have been a somewhat peripheral member.
Yes, your address?
14 Woodcrest Road. Somewhat peripheral member of this town. I work in Portland. I enjoy the jewel of Fort Williams. I cheer sports teams. Appreciate our schools. But that peripheral engagement changed for me one day last November when I was on the green hill behind the football stadium at the high school, and I learned of an incident that had just taken place that was very disturbing to me. I also learned it was not the only one, and these were not incidents in California or Texas or Portland. I realized these were incidents in Cape Elizabeth, and I felt that something had to be done. I didn't know what shape it would take. But it seemed crystal clear to me that the people of our town needed to gather in some way and say it was not okay for people of color, for people who are Muslim, or for people who immigrated here from another country to be told that they did not belong. I soon realized I was not alone in this concern. As some of us began to meet, our group began to grow. And I should say, some of in our group are more likely to be subject to acts of racism and xenophobia than people like me. But I do believe it is our responsibility and my responsibility to stand by our neighbors when they are subject to fear and intimidation. Our group is one of several initiatives in town. Lily Frame is back there. Her group at the high school recently put on an astounding event. 170 people came for an event where students organized to have people get to know each other across their differences. I saw Afghan chicken curry. I saw Burundian beef tongue, Portuguese cod cake. And due to my tenuous connection to my Scottish, English, French heritage, I brought cheesecake. I realized there, though, looking at 170 people gathered with very little advance warning, that there's a hunger to learn about each other's differences and to discover the ways we may be more alike than we know. I also recognize there may be concerns among council members about supporting a resolution like this. There may be questions about whether it's too political. There may be concerns about whether it's even necessary to take a position like this. And there may be a sense that the town council should simply be a neutral body. And I don't want to dismiss these considerations. But however, In standing for this resolution, I view it as a document imbued with the best of American values, not Democratic values or Republican values. At important points of our history, there are moments in which we define ourselves. And at these moments, neutrality is highly problematic. In 1963, John F. Kennedy found it to be such a time. He made a case that the rights of African Americans to attend college in Alabama should matter to everyone. And if you can forgive the male-centric language of that time, this is what he said: "The rights of every man are diminished when the rights of one man are threatened." This resolution, I think, sends a message that we stand with our neighbors if they feel threatened. It sends a message that people of all cultures, all skin colors, all religions are welcome to be a part of our community. And it sends a message that we are not neutral about the right of our residents to be treated with dignity and to live without fear. Thank you.
Thank you very much. At this point, is there a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Sarah?
I move that we adopt the resolution welcoming all people as set forth in our agenda.
Is there a second? Patty?
I'll second that.
Discussion from councilors. Jessica?
I wonder if I could ask a question of the school superintendent who's here.
Sure. Please. Dr. Coulter, would you mind stepping forward?
Yes, ma'am.
Hi. Hi. Hello, Howard. I understand, I have an email string from last fall, that this was a situation that something occurred anyway in the school department. And my question to you is, what was done, and did you deal with this within as our superintendent, and what was the outcome, and so forth?
Mm-hmm. Well, let me start off by trying to describe what I believe happened. I wasn't there to observe it, but what I understand happened was that during a football game, I think it was a playoff game, some students, I believe they were middle school age students from two communities, one of them being Cape Elizabeth, the other might have been Wells, I'm not sure, Wells, were in a game of tag football of their own, just enjoying playing together while a football game was going on, high school age football game. And at some point, there was an exchange of strong feelings among the young people, and got into a kind of a yelling, pushing match. And I believe that one student, ethnic minority, I believe, correct, was things were said to him that were very unkind, and I think it would be fair to say were threatening and racist. But and other students stood up and said that they wouldn't have that, and ultimately adults stepped forward, and I believe a peace officer stepped forward and said, "Let's calm this thing down," and everybody kind of broke up. After that weekend game, there was communication between the administration from Cape Elizabeth High School with the administration from the Wells School District. And I believe that in the end, each set of administration felt that they were going to handle it in their own school, and they did. And I believe that there might have been some communication locally with students and perhaps parents. I don't believe anybody was disciplined for this. It was basically seen as this was a serious problem, and it was an opportunity to reinforce our values and beliefs and to educate rather than to be punitive. So I think that in the end we felt that we made it clear that what had happened shouldn't be repeated.
So if I'm to understand you, the Cape Elizabeth students were, shall we say, counseled by the school department in any way? They weren't disciplined, but were they counseled in any way by the school department?
I was not involved in meeting with students, so I don't know. I can't speak for what happened with the students and the administration. I was told by the administration, and to include the principal and athletic director, that they, and I believe this involved the principal from the middle school, that there was discussion. I don't know to what degree. I wouldn't want to mislead you about what was said, or I don't have the details, ma'am.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Further discussion? Sarah.
I think it's important to look at this in a far bigger context than as a reaction to the few incidents that happened with kids, which were highly unfortunate. You could argue that the spark that started this came from that, but I think that it's much more ambitious and much more big picture and aspirational and positive rather than reactionary or in some way like, oh my gosh, we got to cover ourselves because something might happen. I don't think that's the spirit of it at all. I think that this is stepping out there, like a few other communities done, to say, hey, Cape Elizabeth is a great town, we're warm, we're open, we welcome you, please come. And, you know, I think we would all love it if people, more diverse people came and brought their backgrounds and the richness to our community. And for what it's worth, since that Portland Press Herald article was published, which was unfortunate that my name was throughout it because I feel like I got credit where credit was not due. It was fully credit for this committee and somehow my name got attached to it. But that being what it is, I cannot tell you how many people have texted me, emailed me, stopped me on the street, stopped me in church and said, thank you so much for doing this, which each time I had to say, it's not me, I'm not doing it. But there has been such a positive reaction toward me from every person, and I haven't had one person say, why are you doing this, or you don't need to, or what are you thinking? So that's just a sort of a observation on the ground that this has been received with joy from those who I've talked to.
Other discussion? Penny.
I just want to say that in concept, I don't disagree with this direction, but the fact that we received some additional input today relative to the crafting of the content. I think that what I would propose, and I don't know what the normal operating procedure is, but what I would propose is that I think that the council take it into a workshop, work through what wording will help us achieve what we want to achieve, and not have unintended consequences to it. And so that would be my proposal. So I don't know if that requires another motion or whatever.
You could make a motion to amend the motion that's already on the floor. Okay. The motion that's on the floor right now is to accept the resolution as it was presented in the agenda.
Okay.
If you'd like to make a motion to amend that, to refer the item to a workshop for discussion, then you can make that, and if there's a second and it passes, then
okay. I would make a motion that to amend the what is currently on the floor so that we can take this under into a workshop and work through what the wording needs to be in order to achieve what we want to achieve. And I would hope that what we would do is ask for input from the people who have helped to create this so that we can come up with something that works for our town. That's mine.
Okay. There's a motion to amend the original motion. Is there a second for that motion to amend? Kathy.
I'll second that, and I'd like to say a few words.
Go ahead.
I don't disagree with what's been said by the group. In fact, I think maybe we all on some level agree. I do have a problem with the wording of this resolution. One of the reasons I have a problem is because of the inclusion of immigration status. As a counselor, and as all counselors, we take an oath to uphold town and state law. So the immigration status piece is concerning to me. I think that the school has proactively addressed the issue. Schools have to do these kind of things. It's a learning environment, and even adults have to learn. But I do question the council's role in this. Some of the other reasons I have a problem is we heard over the weekend that there was a group that said, we're not included in this. And it was an unintended consequence, but then I think to myself, what other unintended consequences are out there? You know, are there other groups that we have forgotten? And so for me, when we start listing groups of people, I think we run the risk of leaving someone out. I looked at Westbrook's resolution, I looked at South Portland's, and I found them to be more vanilla. I don't want to degrade what they did, but there was some wording in theirs that didn't list people, so it didn't exclude people, and I'm concerned about excluding people. I agree that we should send it to workshop. I had asked, and I think maybe some others had asked, about the police chief's input on this. The police chief has some concerns about some ambiguity, as does the town attorney. And so I don't disagree with the flavor, with the idea, but I think that we have to be more active in how we want this to be worded. I think we need to spend some more time, do some more discussion, maybe talk with some more people, so that when we come back with a product, it's something that everybody can say, I agree with this. So again, I don't disagree with the idea, but I disagree with the way it's worded at the moment. So I seconded the motion to send it to workshop. Thank you.
Other discussion on the amendment? Patty?
Yeah, I mean, I want to first of all say that I totally agree with this resolution as far as from a point of view of how we have our values in this community. And I would hope that these type of things are just one tiny dark spot in a community that shines. I feel like what we're trying to do here is to completely shine a light on things so that we can have it be a positive thing. I'm open to going to workshop. I don't know, for me personally, I feel like this is a proactive and a symbolic motion. I feel like there's no action being taken, and I feel like that totally as a community, I know that, and we've just said, we all agree with these values. The attorney made some comments, and they were just, you know, a changing of semantics with just a couple words. So I was prepared to approve this and the sentiment this evening, but if what the council would like to do is go to a workshop, I'm happy to do that as well.
Thank you. Other discussion on the amendment?
I'm happy to go to a workshop to further explore this. I think that it seems as if the school department dealt with this. We certainly have a moral obligation to treat all humans with dignity and respect. And I think we do that at Cape Elizabeth. Things do occur. Something occurred last fall. The school department dealt with it. But I've seen a couple other issues that concern me greatly. We are being asked to affirm and promote a political statement on behalf of a private organization. And as a council, we don't do that. We haven't done it in the past. Recently, a few years ago, we were asked to join another community to condemn tar sands, and the council declined to do so. And so while I support the intent of this, I have a process and a procedural concern, because if we affirm and promote this resolve, then are we going down a slippery slope to affirm the resolves of other organizations that will want to promote their views and will want town council support to do that? No matter how valuable and important that they may be, and what criteria do we use to make those decisions as to which group has a better or more important or more valuable message that requires the support of the town council? So that's a big concern for me, and perhaps we can explore that to workshop at a workshop, but that's a concern I have.
Caitlin?
Since everybody's chimed in, I figured I will. I also 100% support and agree with the concept and the symbolism of what we're trying to put forward, but those few word tweaks that we got in an email from the town attorney, you know, being an attorney myself, one word here and one word there, it means a lot. So I don't want to be editing it up here tonight because that doesn't give it justice that it deserves. So I too agree that we need to take it to workshop so that if this is going to be moved forward, it has the exact wording that the town wants it and needs it to have.
Sarah?
I'm happy to take it to a workshop. I actually agree with Patty that this is more of a sort of in spirit than, I don't think anyone expects us to cover every possible person that we don't want to exclude, because of course that list would go on forever. But if people want to tighten it or whatever, make it so it's palatable, I think that's fine. I mean, I think it'd be great if ultimately we arrived at a place where this was unanimous. We might not get there, but in terms of supporting one group, we've passed resolutions in the past that came, for example, Pulaski, that was a political group, and they can't, you know, we passed that. It was to try to head off, it was complicated, it had to do with budget, but the impetus was that's a political group and they wanted us, you know, and we said, no, thank you, we don't want to do that. So we do have a history of looking at resolutions that people bring. That's generally why they come to us. And I don't feel that this is a group in town that's a specified, defined group. It's more of this growing coalition. I mean, 170 people showed up there, there's kids in the school. It's very flexible, it's very amorphous. It's not like this small group with an agenda. So I just want to clarify that. I don't see this as taking the agenda of a well-defined group and them asking us to affirm and promote what they're doing. I don't think that's the spirit of it. But, you know, we all agree that we should go to workshop, and so I think that's a good solution, short-term solution. So I'm in favor.
Is there any other discussion? I want to thank the group for not only being here tonight to express your views and present the matter for us, and Dr. Coulter for giving us the additional context about what happened back in the fall. I also agree wholeheartedly with the sentiment expressed in the resolution. I think that at its foundation, it is a affirmative statement of our values as a community, and as Kathy on down the line here, I think we all share in that. The one key thing for me that is different from this as compared to our neighboring communities like Westbrook and South Portland is that this is something that was citizen-driven as opposed to being a council-driven item. So I think as just a matter of process and a matter of, you know, fully contemplating and as we've all referenced, making sure that we're not including anything that yields to an unintended consequence, that we should take it to a workshop. And furthermore, I think have some good, robust discussion amongst us as counselors, who I know have differing views on this. And I think through that process, my hope is that we'll be able to come to more of a consensus position on language that I hope that we'll all be able to get behind in some way. So with that being said, I'll call the question on the amendment, which is to send this, refer this to a future workshop. All those in favor of the amendment? Thank you. I think technically we then have to vote on the amended item, which is instead of accepting the resolution, then actually going ahead and referring it to. So just to make sure we're all buttoned up on that. All those in favor of referring this to a workshop for discussion? Thank you very much. Thank you again, everybody. Appreciate it.
Mr. Chairman, I'll work on pulling some dates together and email the council tomorrow morning.
Okay.
If I get a chance to look at the big scheduler board to see what we have for available dates. And,
we do have a workshop currently on the calendar for May 1st.
Yes.
And I think that would, given that our 25th and 26th are specifically for budget, the May 1st workshop would be in advance of the May 8th regular monthly meeting. And so if the agenda allows, I would propose that would be the best time to pick this up. So.
We can. And I'll reach out to I know some folks as well in the audience who I'll reach out to let them know so they can pass the word along as well. So.
That would be great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is number 64-2017. It's a recommendation to appoint Kevin Guimond to serve on the vacated opening on the Comprehensive Plan Committee. Is there a motion? Sarah?
I just speak on behalf of the Appointments Committee. I would just like to thank all the people who both applied and reapplied for the position. There's great interest in this committee. I think 7 people applied. And again, it's painful to say no because all of them were great. It was a difficult decision. But we are very excited to be recommending Kevin Guimond. I think it's
Guimond.
From 170 Ocean House Road to join the Comp Plan Committee. He's a bundle of energy and good ideas, and I hope he'll accept our recommendation.
Is there a second? Jessica, any discussion?
Second. I'll just quickly say that I couldn't be more pleased as past chair and a member of the Appointments Committee that Kevin, we came forth for a position a couple years ago and we could not put him on even though we wanted to. And so I'm just so happy that his talent and expertise will be brought forth to be part of this. I think he'll be excellent.
Great. Any other discussion? All those in favor? Great. Next up is item number 65-2017, proposed amendment to the charge for the Harbors Committee. Kathy, did you want to introduce this?
No, I think
no.
Matt does.
I'm sorry.
I'd be happy to.
I thought when we spoke, you said that she was going
to. No, that's okay.
My mistake.
Kathy and I had spoken about this a bit. She's one of our members of the Harbors Committee, as well as Caitlin. So. This is kind of following from a discussion or a request from the town planner and presumably the Comprehensive Planning Committee to try to get some assistance when it came to the marine resources concept of the or chapter of the upcoming comprehensive plan. And I took some time and spoke with Maureen to get some more clarification on this today. And it's more along that lines of asking for assistance in it, not to actually have them write the whole chapter. So. It's looking to use a lot of the work that gets done by the Harbors Committee to, the way that Maureen would phrase it would be the last time Marine Resources chapter left a little bit on the table. It would be a nice way to put it. They didn't have the...
That's very wise.
So this way, this is a good opportunity, especially in light of the fact that the Harbors Committee is working on all the good efforts that they're putting together to actually have a very informed and comprehensive chapter of that of the new plan. So they're not looking for them to completely write it because there is some concern about passing off a chapter to a group to have do, but to really pull in a lot of their information to make it a much stronger document. And that's why they'd placed this request forward. And we had brought it up at the Harbors Committee last week. They didn't get the opportunity to vote on it, to adopt it, but after speaking with Councillor Jordan, she said, you know, this should probably be placed on the council agenda to make this more formal so the committee is not getting distracted from their charge.
Okay. Jessica?
I'd be more comfortable if the language, you've got to assist in writing the marine resources section of the comprehensive plan, and to go along with what you actually just said, I'd be more comfortable if we change that to assist the comprehensive plan as needed, or something like that. The reason I say that is this, to me, on the face of it, gives the Harbors Committee an opportunity that no other committee has in addressing the comp plan. You know, like Conservation Commission, Committee, excuse me, which might have something that they would want to contribute. And some of their things can certainly be technical with regards to RP wetlands and so forth and so on.
Sure.
You know, I mean, the Harvest Committee's stuff is, can be fairly technical. So, I would like to see that tweak made. I mean, because,
I'm open to suggestion.
Because otherwise, there are other committees that would legitimately feel slighted, that they aren't being asked to write, be involved in writing the comp plan. Conversely, we have a comprehensive plan committee of people who have signed on to basically write the new comp plan, and I wouldn't want to take away from their responsibilities and they will want assistance, of course, but I think the word writing, maybe we could tweak that a little
sure,
bit.
Sure.
Penny?
As a member of the Comprehensive Plan Committee, I can tell you that one of the things that we are doing is outreach to the various groups that and committees that exist in order that they can help craft those sections of the plan. And when I saw assist in writing, I read it as input drafting, helping to craft, ensuring that it's comprehensive and covers. So writing to me is an iterative process. It's and it's not just going to be their words, but they'll have input into the words. I, as a committee member, am not expecting to write those sections unless I happen to be assigned one of them. So I didn't have a problem with what I interpreted here, but we're going to reach out to other groups too.
Should I take a shot at a motion that incorporates what Jessica said but keeps the spirit of it?
Sure.
We have made a motion, right? So how about if we just say, I move that we amend the charge for the Harbor Committee to include assisting the comprehensive plan with the marine resource section of
that's
the
good.
Plan.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
That's
so
good.
We just have, I just left the word writing out.
Yep.
And then just going to assist us with the section.
Could you just restate that quickly for
yep.
Deb's benefit?
Sorry, Deb. I move.
Mine too, but.
I'm just switching words up. I move that we amend the charge for the Harbors Committee to include assisting the Comprehensive Plan Committee with the Marine Resource section of the plan.
That's good.
Is there a second?
I second that.
Penny, any discussion? Caitlin, was there a point you wanted to make?
I just, a question or a thought as to what, that looks like going forward, assist. So, I mean, as a member of the Harvest Committee, we're doing, all, as Kathy will attest to, it seems like a lot of learning and education, and so when you say assist the comprehensive plan, are we giving them reports? Are we, I just want, so that we can go back to the Harbors Committee and say, this is what the council means by what they just said. A little direction. Yeah, that's just so we can take that back to the next meeting with a little more direction than.
So let me take a stab at that since we're both on the comp plan. Yeah. I think what I interpret that means is that we'll have conversations with them up front as we're just beginning the chapter. So before we make changes or decide anything. So they'll have input from the beginning, which as Penny points out, other committee, we're hoping that groups all over town are gonna help us do that. And then they can say, oh, it'd be much better if you included this, this, and this, or that, that, and that. And then we'll have a conversation as a group. Maureen will write a draft. It'll come back, and then we'll edit it. And I would hope that during that whole process that whoever wants to from the Harbor Committee could be there as part of the conversation. So they're really at the table having the conversation with us, but they're not physically writing the words.
Right, and so from the Harbors Committee point of view, we have to make ourselves as knowledgeable as possible so that we can properly comment and
Right.
And that's what we hope they'll do, is to educate us.
Right. So that's, I'm just trying to, as a direction for the Harbors Committee, we need to make sure that we know X, Y, and Z so that when it's written down or asked about, we can knowledgeably answer Z, Y, and X.
I don't even know what I don't know. So they can start from scratch with me.
There's a lot that we didn't know that we didn't know when we started this.
I would consider the subject matter experts.
That's perfect.
Matt, do you want to add something?
Yeah, just in concert with that idea, the Harbors Committee has their charge that takes them up through the end of the year. So a lot of your work will be completed while the Comprehensive Plan Committee is still very much engaged with what they need to do. So the product from the committee, I think, would be timed very well to come online at about the time that they may want to think about engaging that part of the comp plan, I would think. So the dominoes may line up pretty well as far as how the calendar breaks, with where your work product could be, you know, where the committee's work product could be complete. And then that would be a tremendous resource versus before, where it was, okay, let's go down and talk to Jody and ask him about what we've done wrong. You know, or, I mean, that's a little bit, there'll be a lot better served with this work product, I think. So I think that's kind of the thought, more so at that point. Okay. If that's helpful.
Kathy?
The only thing I'm concerned about is, you know, when it gets down to the reports, I don't want to take away from the Comprehensive Plans Committee to say, thank you for this piece, thank you for this piece, but it's their report. So they include what they want.
Right.
And I don't want any one group to say, no, you have to put this in because we have the right to give you this section and that's it. You know, sometimes if we blur the lines too much, it's not clear who has the authority over what. And I think the sentiment is great, but I don't want, you know, I don't know. Caitlin writes something and I'm on the comprehensive plan and I don't like it. You know, do I have the authority to say, you know, thank you for that, Caitlin, and I'll keep that in mind when we write our comprehensive plan. So I don't want the lines to be so blurred that we're all holding hands and singing Kumbaya and everything's going fine, but then at some point we're not. Somebody's not holding hands and singing Kumbaya. And so now we're, you know, well, I have the authority to do this. No, you don't, I do. And so, you know.
But the way we've written it is super soft. We're just saying they can assist us with the process of looking at it.
And
we're not handing them any power.
Right. But, and I just want to be clear that the power is with the Comprehensive Plan Planning Committee to do what they want in their report.
Right. I think that's clear.
You know, I just want to make sure, you know, that we don't get that Caitlin going off on somebody.
She's not on the Harvard.
Oh, yes, she is.
Oh, you are.
Yeah, no. But you know, I had to use you as an example. Like, but you know what I was trying to say. I just want to make sure. Comprehensive Plan Committee's report is their report.
Yeah.
To do what they want.
That's a good point.
Any other discussion? All right. All those in favor of the motion to amend the charge of the Harbors Committee, as we've discussed. Great, thank you. Next item is number 66-2017, request for extension by the Conservation Committee for completing the work on the Paper Street technical study for the paper streets outlined here. I'll introduce this. So you'll remember that back in October when we were voting and working through the disposition of paper streets for the ones that are listed here, I had specifically at the time made a motion requesting that the Conservation Committee undertake some work on a study. I know that they have been doing that. I also know that the bulk of the 6 months that was the window that we gave them to do that work was through the winter months, so sometimes some of the field work that was necessary for that was compromised by the weather. So the request before us is on whether or not to, they're effectively at the end of the 6 month window now, and obviously the work is not complete, so they're asking for it to be extended to June 30th. So That's the item before us. So is there a motion to extend the deadline for the Paper Street technical study?
So moved.
Caitlin, is there a second? Jessica, any discussion?
Mr. Chairman, just as a point, I had the opportunity to talk with Maureen about this as well. They're looking to do the work within the next couple of weeks. Part of it is because spring's taken a while to get here. The plants that they actually need to see out in the field to verify if it's a wetland or not, quite frankly, haven't started to come up yet. So that's one of the areas that they have as far as, and as well as getting out there to do the survey work. Their hope is that they can complete the work and get the report to the committee so they can review it in their May meeting. And Maureen's take was that they also, the first draft will probably not be the final draft. So there will probably be a revision after that. So they would have that done in June. And then possibly it may be good to, now we run into July and August, that we look at trying to put this on the September agenda. So you don't run into jam ups with council members' plans in the summertime, as well as the neighborhoods who are affected by this, because folks are in and out. So it may be good to start the fall off with that at that point in time. But they should have everything wrapped up at that point in time and ready for council consumption. Just as a furtherance of the point, I just thought it might be important for council to know that.
Mm-hmm. Any other discussion? Sarah?
I mean, I agree with Matt that the calendar is unfortunate, because now we're just delaying and postponing longer. But I guess it's been years, so what's another few months? It sounds to me like the process you described, is it because they only meet once a month, so if they look at the first draft in May, they can't then create a second draft by the end of May? Because if we could get it by the end of May, it could go on our June agenda, but they don't. That's not how they work.
I think there's two different aspects here. Number one is that the engineering firm that is conducting part of the technical field work is going to deliver their component of the assessment and review and all that kind of stuff. And then the Conservation Committee still has, and a point I wanted to actually reemphasize as this item's on the agenda, is that when I made the motion in October, and I'm reading from it right now, it was to encompass a thorough assessment of the technical and logistical feasibility along with all other practical considerations to determine a complete cost-benefit analysis of any potential trail development. So it's my hope that that technical feasibility fieldwork result is but just one component of a comprehensive report that takes into account all those other things. So it's my expectation that they'll get that work and still need to do more in order to come back to us with a full assessment, which is what was requested. So.
Okay, so if we put our discussion off till September, I'm okay with that. But I do think it's hard for, I mean, there's a lot of citizens who are very interested in this, and I think it's really sort of unfair to schedule in July because so many people can't come. So I agree with you, Matt, that mm-hmm. if it's in September, that's fine.
Any other discussion? Okay, all those in favor of the motion on the floor right now to extend the Paper Street deadline to for the feasibility study to June 30th? Great, thank you. Next item up on the agenda is 67-2017, a commercial lease agreement for building 326 at Fort Williams Park. It's recommended that we approve the lease agreement, which we all received in our packet. Matt, did you have anything you wanted to add on this? Or?
Sure, I'd be happy to. Behavioral Health Resources is currently a tenant that we have, and so they're expanding their use that they have, so they're looking at this space. It's a three-year term starting on June 1st and ending in May 31st, 2020. It's approximately 2,954 square feet building area. And the rents are all laid out there, but it's roughly $7.86 per square foot over the term the first year, and then it advances from that point each year for the first 3 years with a two-year renewal that they do have. This company has been a solid tenant, no payment issues, so been current and consistent. So Greg has worked with this person, and I think it's been a good negotiation and a good lease for the town to have. And there's also language in this one that is going, you'll be seeing on new renewals that come up or new leases that come up relative specifically to snow removal. So in the past, there's been some additional charges that have come in there, and we've kind of eaten those charges. So now this lease is one of the first ones that has language that states that they're going to be able to pass that through as a CAM charge or common area maintenance charge. That was a good point that Greg brought up in this new lease. So we're going to have winters like we have. It's good to be able to do something with that. But overall, they've been a good tenant, and they take more space if it was available. So it's a good thing.
Is there a motion to approve the agreement? Patty?
I move to approve the commercial lease agreement for building 326 Fort Williams Park with Behavioral Health Resources.
Is there a second? Sarah, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Great, thank you. Next item is 68-2017, authorization for culvert assessment grant. I know Maureen spoke to you about this, Matt. You want to tee that up?
I would be happy to, Mr. Chairman. Yes, this is we were talking about this at the Harbors Committee last week. There's this grant that the state does provide. It's a coastal zone management grant, and Maureen had been working on making this application, and it gives us the opportunity, especially in light of we're doing this MS or stormwater, is a very big concern now, and taking care of it is and ultimately a huge concern to make sure. So culverts is just one of those components of which stormwater does pass along through. With this coming forward, it gives us the opportunity, if we receive the grant, to go in and determine what condition they are in, and we'll find out. And the application for this is due on April 28th, and so the idea is that we can get the work done this summer if we receive the grant. We do have, we're looking at a potential exposure of $4,200. However, the reason why we haven't placed that number in here is Maureen has also been working with a couple of other public agencies to try to receive additional support to offset what the town's input may be. So instead of limiting us and saying, okay, we're going to pony up all $4,200, if she can get a grand or two out of a couple of these other agencies that are out there, that would offset what the town's participation would be. But she didn't want to hamstring it with that. So, but overall, it's a really good project, and nothing ventured, nothing gained. If we can actually receive the grant, this would be a good opportunity for the town to get some work that we need to get done accomplished as well.
Thank you, Matt.
Yes, sir.
Is there a motion to authorize the request for the grant application?
So motion.
Sarah, second. Patty?
I'll second that.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? Great, thank you. Next item is 69-2017, the accessory structures amendment. Patty, do you want to introduce this?
Basically 2 months ago, this came before the council and we brought it up. It was in December or so that Jaycox came forward and said that there was some issue with the language that was before us. We sent it off to planning board to be reviewed. They brought it back to us. We went to the ordinance committee to kind of look at that language and have said that we see no further changes, and we want to approve what was written.
Thank you very much. Is there a motion that we accept the recommendation of the ordinance committee and take no specific action on the accessory structures language?
So moved.
Caitlin, second. Sarah, any discussion? I know that this was a deliberate process, and I'm just glad that we went through it. I know some people got frustrated by it, but it is, I think it was the right steps to go through. So anyway, all those in favor? Great. Next item is 70-2017. The recycling committee has submitted their goals to us. I always like seeing the recycling committee goals, having been a former member of the recycling committee myself. Is there a motion to accept the recycling committee's goals?
So moved.
Thank you, Caitlin. Second?
Second it.
Penny? Any discussion? Jessica?
Everybody's hanging up.
Well, I'm very pleased to be receiving committee goals because, you know, we've reached out to committees and asked them to provide us their goals. I do have a question on their first goal. However, because to my knowledge, there is no proposed town ordinance at the moment. on single-use bags and polystyrene foam. We did have a brief discussion, but I don't think we have anything currently in play.
Yeah, I believe...
I was confused by that.
Yeah, no, probably a good question, and maybe you can, Matt, comment before I jump in here randomly, but it was sent, I believe, to the ordinance committee. Mm-hmm. It is on our agenda. We pushed it off because we had things that were more time-sensitive, specifically the shooting range ordinance and the marijuana issue. I would say, as I have to speak right now, to the recycling committee, please take our not pushing it off as no indication we don't find your work valuable and important, and we will be sure to keep them in the loop as we get to the item so that they're there to share talking points and everything else and to pursue this goal. But there was referred, I believe, and yes. Perhaps you can confirm that. Yeah.
I think it may have been in December. Okay. I think it was before I joined the council, because I didn't. I was included on your email response to the gentleman that had emailed you a week or two ago, and I said I quickly went in and asked Maureen. Right. She said, "Oh, that happened back prior to there." So, but yeah, she had it on their plate, but it just hasn't come forward yet because of the other issues. Sorry.
Well, Jessica. what I was getting at was that I mean, I have no problem with it. I was just thinking if this is an order of priority, and I didn't see this, and I was checking your minutes and maybe I missed it, but I was just going to suggest that, you know, timely wise, maybe this should be priority number two or three or four, that's all, because I didn't see anything in the works, and I didn't know if this was ranked, I guess is, you know what I'm saying. Yeah. That's all.
Any other discussion? Kathy.
So I'm sort of going to take off a little bit on what Jessica said, but it says track and support the proposed town ordinances on single-use bags and polystyrene foam. The ordinance committee hasn't started this, but what if the ordinance committee and the council decides not to restrict these? Is the recycling committee going to support that? Because it implies that they're going to support the town ordinances, and so I read that and I was kind of a little baffled because I thought, okay, are they going to support it if it goes their way and not if it doesn't? I mean, I'm not trying to be rude, but I just, you know, nobody knows how an ordinance is going to draft out and where it's going to go. And so I read it sort of a little differently and said, okay, we don't have any ordinances. We know it's going to be on the agenda, but what if it's not? What if the recycling committee does not agree with the way it goes? I mean, the recycling committee is a town committee, so presumably they will support whatever the council decides. But I was just a little baffled by that.
Sarah?
I read it that they're going to track and support, they say proposed, mm-hmm. i.e. they're going to advocate to the ordinance committee that it passes, which is an unusual group of citizens when it has to do with them, come in, attend all the meetings. I mean, the farmers show up with the signs and the abutters showed up at the short-term rentals. It's part of what they're supposed to be doing as citizens. So I didn't have an issue with that. I didn't think it implied if the ordinance doesn't go their way, that they're therefore gonna be oppositional. I thought that's why it was first, because they were saying, this looks like it might be the shortest term of all these goals, and they're gonna try to advocate for it, which I think is part of their job. But anyway, that being aside, that wasn't my comment. My comment was I was really happy to see this, because I think it's great that they're broadening out their charge to more than just making sure the town recycles, because we've had great success with that, and I feel like it's a really energetic committee, and they can take on more things. I love that they're volunteering to help, you know, town at the swap shop and so forth and Family Fun Day. I like that they want to do education, they want to visit other schools and learn. I just am happy to see that they're very energized and that they want to do a whole host of things bigger and more than just trying to up the recycling percentage in CAPE. So I think this is great. I'm thrilled and I'm going to support it.
Other discussion? I'll jump in and say that number one, The item relating to single-use bags tracks all the way back to our 2016 goals. It was a goal that I put forth in 2016, so the work that the committee has done on this topic and why it continues in their goals is in response directly to requests, you know, by its inclusion in our goals, that it be a topic area that they research and come back to us with recommendations on. I did not infer from this, though I can see how the wording might be a little confusing for some, and it could be interpreted different ways, but I did not infer that they were being presumptive about an ordinance that has not yet even been written or proposed or anything like that. I think that as drafting goals as one does at a single point in time, they were probably just assuming that that was going to be the natural progression of the issue moving forward. So I didn't take any particular offense, if you will, at any inferred point there. And quite lastly, I want to put in a plug for the home composting workshop that is, you can find it in your community services catalog. It's a very cool thing that the recycling committee is going to be offering up in May. If you're interested in home composting, you can sign up for that. It is free, and there's going to be an expert composter. So it was one of the things that was part of their goals as well under number three. With that all being said, all those in favor of accepting the recycling committee's goals and thanking them for their submission. Thank you very much. Last regular scheduled item on the agenda is number 71-2017, the municipal election warrant. Deborah?
Yes, thank you very much. The warrant does call for the Tuesday, June 13th school budget validation, referendum, and Portland Water District trustee election. You'll see that the questions are whether or not to favor the budget, and then the non-binding expression of opinion for consideration, too high, acceptable, and too low. And again, there's a water district trustee unexpired term up that will expire in November 2019. There's also a state bond question on June 13th, so technically we'll be holding three elections at once on the 13th. And the election will be held either in the gym or the cafeteria. We believe we can be in the cafeteria. We're hoping for that. There was great response in November. So in response to that, hopefully that's where that election will be. So the warrant is in order for your signature this evening.
Is there a motion? Jessica.
I move that we approve the warrant for the June 13, 2017 school budget validation referendum and Portland Water District trustee elections.
Second. Patty?
I'll second that.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Great. Thank you very much. You'll have to sign that afterwards.
Yes.
At this point, that's the conclusion of our regular agenda item. There are no members from the public interested in speaking to anything not on the agenda. One thing I will add, I should have mentioned at the beginning, I want to thank you, Deb and Matt, for your attendance, but thank you, Deb, for all the work you did to organize the boards and committees event that we had last week, which was really well attended and helpful for, I think, everybody that was in attendance. I know it was a lot of work on your part, and I appreciate that very much, so thank you so much. If there's nothing else, motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Caitlin, second?
I'll second that.
All those in favor? Great. Thank you very much.